Newell, and I am the in charge of special projects here at the Athens County Historical Society and Museum. I thank you all for being here tonight. October is Ohio Archaeology Month, and I don't know whether you're aware, but most states have a month that they designate as Archaeology Month, and they get to choose what month that is, and the governor has decided that October is Archaeology Month for Ohio. And we're excited about that because we like to have presentations and lectures and discussions about what is archaeology in Ohio. We are very pleased tonight to have Dr. Brett Ruby here from the National Park Service. He is, as you can see, part of the Hopewell Cultural National Historic Park. He is the park archaeologist there. Dr. Ruby grew up in Ohio. This is home for him. He went to Kent State for his undergraduate work, and then for his graduate work, he went to Indiana University. He then got a job at Hopewell Cultural Center and worked there for a while, and then decided to branch out. He was kind of urged to branch out, and he went to, as an archaeologist for the Army. And I would bet most of you don't know that all of our federal agencies who are land-owning agencies have archaeologists. And I tell this to students because many of them have heard from parents or somebody else, oh, you can't get a job as an archaeologist. Well, most government agencies that own land have archaeologists, and Brett worked for the Army in a variety of places in Texas and Washington State for a while. And then he was fortunate enough to come back to Ohio, to Chillicothe, and for the Hopewell Center. So we are very excited to hear him talk tonight about the Great Circle Project, which is relatively new. If you follow the Hopewell, if you follow the kinds of things that are going on at Hopewell Cultural Center, this is something that has only fairly recently been something that we've looked at. So I'm excited about this. Brett?
Thank you very much, Lynn. Thanks. And thank you all for being here. I'm excited to be able to share with you the results of a recent field project. Actually, it's sort of an ongoing project. We're still in process, so this will be sort of a progress report. But this was an opportunity to look at a different aspect of the Hopewell Mounds and earthworks that you're so familiar with, I'm sure. This was an opportunity to look at a huge architectural feature that's out there at the Hopewell Mound Group site between the mounds and the earthworks there. So it's been, you know, the Hopewell Mound Group is the biggest and the baddest of all the Hopewell sites, and I'm going to give you some sense of that here tonight. But right under our noses, for 200 years, people have been doing archaeology there, and this feature, the Great Circle, has been largely overlooked all that time. So what I'm going to do tonight, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the earliest explorations there, and the first discovery of this, and I'm going to tell you about how this was lost and found again recently. I'll tell you what we did in the field, and then in the concluding portion, try and put this Great Circle in the context of other American Indian ceremonial sites that stretch some, I think there's connections that stretch back maybe 4,000 years with the Great Circle all the way up to the present day. So let me launch in here. So this is the Scioto Paint Creek Confluence area in Ross County, Ohio, and the blinking site there, that's the Hopewell Mound Group. It's located about 5 miles west of the main trench of the Scioto Valley, on a relatively small little tributary stream, but it sits right in the heart of the world's greatest concentration of geometric earthworks. There's about 25 major mound and earthwork complexes there that encompass tens to hundreds of acres, geometric earthworks, and Hopewell sits sort of in the center of all those. There's, like I said, about 25 within a 20-mile radius of the Hopewell site. And in a lot of ways, it really was the heart of that distribution there. This is the first map of the Hopewell site. Caleb Atwater drew this in 1820, or published it in 1820. And here you can see the major features of the site. There's a huge grate enclosure, sort of an irregularly shaped, D-shaped thing. What that is an earthen wall about 6 feet tall with a ditch on the outside about 6 feet deep. And it runs for about 2.5 miles of earthen wall, encloses 100 acres. Just a phenomenal amount of labor went into building that. There's a regular geometric square attached on one end. That square alone encompasses about 16 acres. If you've ever been to the Mound City Group there at Chillicothe, the whole Mound City Group would fit quite comfortably within that small square enclosure. So this place it's the biggest single enclosure Hopewell ever built. It's got the biggest mound the Hopewell people ever built. Mound 25 there, which was actually sort of three conjoined mounds. That thing was 500 feet long, 180 feet wide, 33 feet tall. And it covered a wooden building, a big three-roomed wooden building of about the same size. Remarkable thing. And inside the great enclosure, there's these two other enclosures. They're both mapped as circles. We now know that this one, in fact, is more of a D-shaped thing. But this feature is the one we're calling the Great Circle, and that was the focus of our project this year. So this is the very famous Squire and Davis map. This was published in 1848, and that's Squire, who was at the time he was a newspaper editor in Chillicothe, and Davis was a physician. Davis sort of bankrolled the operation, and Squire was the one actually really doing the work out on the ground. But they drew this, they produced this phenomenal set of maps. You can see that this map is much more detailed than the Atwater map. It shows the topography out there. You can see that the earthwork actually climbs up on a hill, and then it sort of runs over hill and dale through all these little ravines and comes back down onto this big, broad, flat terrace. And there's things like farm buildings in here and fence lines that give you some sense of the human scale of the thing. You can get a better sense when you can see that, you know, there's a whole house and barn complex there. You get some sense of how huge this thing really is. And so we are really indebted to Squire and Davis for making these great maps. But that sort of leads me into a little bit of an aside. Sarah Bernhardt was indisputably the most famous stage actress of the Gilded Age. And she actually filtered over into the silent film era. But she was the most famous actress in the time, world renowned. So there's a whole group of people here I'm going to show you. And you know, what do these people have in common? You recognize another Ohio native here, William Tecumseh Sherman. Mark Twain, of course. This one's a little less familiar, but striking, isn't he? This is Nikola Tesla. That's Walt Whitman. And that's Oscar Wilde. Okay, so all of these folks have one thing in common. And it's this guy. This is Napoleon Cerroni. And obviously quite a character in his own right. But he was like one of the first paparazzi in the 1890s or so. He would take photographs of famous people and then print up postcards and such and sell them. And that's how he made a living. But he got his start as a lithographer. An engraver and a lithographer making lithographic plates, and in the 1843 he opened his own lithography business in New York City, and one of his first commissions was to produce the 48 lithographic plates in that Squire and Davis book. So he's the one that we have to thank for those gorgeous plates. They're all drawn by Napoleon Cerroni and his staff there. And if it wasn't for the, you know, if they hadn't spent the money to get the best lithographers and the highest production qualities, many of these places we wouldn't have any record of. But thankfully, we have that Squire and Davis, Ancient Monuments in the Mississippi Valley. And it's also worth noting that was the first book published by the Smithsonian Institution, volume number one in the Contributions to Knowledge. And they wanted it to be, they wanted it to stand up against any European press. And it really did. It was recognized when it came off as the finest book ever to issue from an American press in 1848 when it was published. So that was one long aside. Here's another one. 1893. The biggest thing going in 1893 was the World's Columbian Exposition, the Chicago World's Fair. It was opened in 1893 to commemorate 400 years since the Christopher Columbus's crash landing in the Americas. And the goal here was the organizers wanted to show that America had prospered. They wanted to show that America could stand up against any European capital in the world. And so they built a city, the White City, in Chicago. A lot of it was actually sort of paper mache and plaster, but nonetheless, a fabulous thing. And I don't know how many people came, but it was really the greatest cultural event of the Gilded Age. And the organizers of the Columbian Exposition, they wanted to show that America had an antiquity that could stand up against anything in Europe. They wanted to put on the finest display of American antiquities ever mounted, and that's where this guy comes in. This is Warren King Moorhead. And he was born into a wealthy family. You may have heard of King's Island and King's Mills. Okay, that was the King Powder Mills. And so in the Civil War and after, they made munitions and made a killing in the killing business, you might say. And so Warren had the means to sort of indulge his interests, which happened to be archaeology. And so by the time he was about 25 years old, he had already gained quite a reputation for himself as a collector, as an archaeologist. And the organizers of the Columbian Exposition heard about him and hired him to go out and collect a worthy collection to put on display at the World's Fair. And so that's what led him in the late August of 1891. He rolled up on the M.C. Hopewell farm, 7 miles outside of Chillicothe. And that's where the Hopewell name came to be applied to this culture. I'll let you see this here. This is from he published a small report of his investigations there. So you can imagine they rolled in, they set up camp, he sends the cook off to get provisions. And then he pulls out the archaeologist Bible, Squire Davis, you know, and he knew that already that this was the biggest of the Scioto Valley enclosures, and it had been largely untouched. Virtually no excavations had taken place there. So he goes out in the morning, walks over the mounds, selects one for investigation, and very quickly he found that he was in fact finding the most spectacular set of antiquities that had ever been recovered in America. Here's a few examples of the sort of things he was finding. This is actually cut mica. Mica, which is from the Blue Ridge Mountains in western North Carolina. He shipped 55-gallon drums of this stuff back and soap boxes full of mica. He was finding hundreds and hundreds of pounds of it. These are little copper ear spools. They're really complex. Many pieces go into making one of these, but they look kind of like a yo-yo or a pulley, and the little pulley ear spools made of copper from the Great Lakes, from Keweenaw Peninsula, Lake Superior area. These are fossil shark's teeth. All these broken bits here, those are all probably great white sharks. They didn't collect just any kind of fossil shark tooth. They only collected the great whites. But they couldn't resist this one either. That was a megalodon. That's like an ancient, the dinosaur of sharks, this monstrous beast. Those are probably coming from Peninsula, Florida somewhere. This is a famous shot of In a single mound, there was 8,000 of these flint discs. You have one on display, very much like one of these. But these were all sort of stacked up very carefully in the base of this mound, 8,000 some of those. And all of those come from southern Indiana, the raw material. So 300 miles away, somebody carted those, you know, on their back. Marine shells, probably from the Gulf Coast of Florida. Again, a copper thing called a breastplate. These are grizzly bear canines set with freshwater pearls. This is the biggest mound, that great mound 25 that I talked about earlier. You can see how they were excavating these. These are teams of mules with a thing called a slip scraper behind it, which is kind of like a wheelbarrow without a wheel that would scrape along. And they would just back and forth, one scrape at a time. They eventually reduced that great mound 25 down to the mound floor. And in these Hopewell mounds, the mounds actually cover the remains of wooden buildings. And all these objects were, and human remains, were placed in wooden buildings. So at one point you could walk into a building and these things would be laid out on the floor. And then eventually those buildings were dismantled or burned. And then these mounds were built as commemorate the location where those important ceremonies and important people were laid to rest. So here's now, near the base of Mount 25, he found this huge cache of copper axes, 66 copper axes. And they're in like a graded series from one that's like an inch and a half long to the biggest one that's 22 inches long, weighed 38 pounds. I think to this day, it's still the largest native copper artifact ever discovered in America. Remarkable thing. More than 100 of these intricate copper cutouts, native copper pounded into a sheet and then cut into these beautiful but enigmatic shapes. These are knives or projectile points made of crystal quartz, probably from Arkansas. These are a couple of those little copper ear spools that have then been covered with a silver foil. Those are, this is from the Field Museum. I didn't say, when the World's Columbian Exposition closed, these collections became the heart of the Field Museum collections in Chicago. And so the field, so these are all put up by the Field Museum. Recently they photographed all these items and put them up on a website so that they're publicly available. So they use these color cards just as a control on the photography so that it can be color corrected. And scale. And these again are freshwater pearls, and this is a little, probably a wooden object covered in silver. And you can imagine how many clams you'd have to open to find a single pearl, let alone all of these. And there were examples of blankets covered with maybe 100,000 pearls. So that's why the Hopewell, I mean, that's why that site became the type site or the most important of all these sites, and that's why the culture was named after that place, because this sort of thing, in this quality, quantity, and diversity has never been found anywhere else. So that's what makes the Hopewell site so important and such a standout of all the Hopewell sites. More fabulous things cut from mica. And these are obsidian. This is the most exotic of all exotic materials. This is volcanic glass. The closest source of this is in the Rocky Mountains, Yellowstone National Park, Obsidian Cliff in Yellowstone National Park. So somebody transported that stuff 2,500 miles from the Rocky Mountains here to Ohio. And then they crafted these incredible masterpieces of flint knapping. These things are, and you can see the scale there. I love this picture. You know, these things are like 13 inches long. I mean, it's just remarkable. Nowhere else. Okay, back to the Hopewell site. So, Moorhead comes here, 1891, 92. He does his major excavations. He finally publishes something of a report in 1897, and he publishes this map of the Hopewell Works. And It's basically a copy of the Squire and Davis map, but it's got a few annotations on it. One of which here, you can't read it there, but I can read it for you. Scrawled across the great circle is the word obliterated. So between the time Squire and Davis was there in 1847 and Moorhead in 1897, it had been entirely plowed away. He saw no evidence of it. So, but that's the sort of thing that today gets archaeologists all excited, because we've got new technologies that can resurrect these lost earthworks. We know from work at other sites, in particular, you may have heard of Jared Burks, who's the current famous practitioner in Ohio here, who's been finding these using geophysical techniques and magnetometry in particular. We know that in particular, earthworks that had a ditch associated with them, those ditches tend to fill with organic soils that are more magnetic than the surrounding soils, and so we can find them with these magnetometers. And so we got excited about the prospect of taking a magnetometer out to Hopewell Mound Group and seeing what we could find. So in the winter of 2012, 2013, I think it was, we hired Jared, the Park Service hired Jared to come out with his magnetometer. That's the machine he was using at the time. It has three magnetometers on a wheeled cart, chariot thing, and he walks back and forth on a grid and collects data continuously. Now he's actually got a four probe array. He can cover acres and acres in a day, and so as part of our contract, he surveyed all this area outlined in red, about a half of the site, 70 acres. That's one of the largest contiguous sets of magnetic data ever collected in North America. So it's a remarkable thing. And it was a success by any measure. This is the actual magnetic data laid over top of an aerial photograph. And I can point out a couple of things. You know, fragments of that square enclosure, which today, there's no topographic relief left from that square enclosure. You can't see anything on the surface, but yet the foundations of that earthwork are still there. The eastern wall of the great enclosure, in particular, that dark line is marking the ditch, that 6 foot deep ditch, which now there is topographic relief to that feature. You can see it out there, but it's much reduced. It's nowhere near 6 feet tall. And there's just a fragment of that big D-shaped enclosure around the Great Mound 25, which sits there. So you can see we want to keep going with this project and get the rest of that feature. But here's the one this discovery is what prompted our project. That's the Great Circle. Let's zoom in on that feature. So entirely obliterated on the surface, there's no hint of it from the surface, but you can see it has a very distinct, very complex magnetic signature. Mostly you see this very distinct, highly magnetic feature. That's probably the ditch that surrounds the Great Circle. And this is about 400 feet across, so you can put a football field in there quite comfortably. And you can see there's very clearly two gateways in it. Each of those gateways is about 30 feet wide. And, you know, this is in contrast to what Squire and Davis showed. They showed a simple embankment with a single gateway to the north. And so now we know there's two gateways, and they point in different directions. So this is, you know, new data that I'll talk a little bit more later about astronomical alignments, and this is the kind of data you really need to be able to hunt down those kind of features. In the center, there's also things like this is an old fence line. That's probably old barbed wire that's in the soil. This is a modern road and a railroad there, so parts of it have been obliterated. This is a huge high-tension electric wire. Some of that is forgivable because it was invisible after 1897 when these things were put through, unlike many other mounds that were perfectly visible when people destroyed them. But nonetheless, much of it remains. But in the middle are four very large magnetic anomalies. Don't know what those are, but they're about 10 feet in diameter, each of them. maybe some kind of a pit, perhaps, and they seem to be aligned to the cardinal directions, north, south, east, west. And then the thing that really got me intrigued was inside that ditch are these individual anomalies. Each of those is about a meter around, about 3 feet around. They're spaced about 10 feet apart pretty regularly. And you can trace them in fragments all the way around. It's an open question as to whether, you know, what we don't see them here, but that doesn't mean they weren't there. It just means they're not magnetic. And, you know, the magnetometer is very sensitive, but it doesn't find everything. So it's hard to know if it was entirely continuous or not. I think it probably was, because we do see it virtually all the way, pieces of it all the way around. So the focus of our project this year was really to find out, we know these things are here magnetically, but we really don't know what they are. You know, you don't know it's a ditch until you've exposed it and shown it to be a ditch. You don't know these to be what I think they might be, is great big post holes for great big wooden posts. But you don't know that until you actually do some excavation. So that was our project, was to target just the northeast quarter. So we focused in on just the northeast quadrant of the circle, and we had three main goals we wanted to do this year. These little green dots here, each of those is a 50 by 50 centimeter excavation unit spaced on a 10 meter grid. And the point of that was to get a sample of artifacts over the surface of this thing that might tell us what it was used for, what kind of debris were people leaving behind. So we wanted to do that. We opened a 3 by 5 meter excavation unit here to expose two of those post-like anomalies and see what they really are. And then we extended a trench 10 meters long out across the ditch to see if it really was a ditch. So those are the 50 by 50s. Those really found mostly negative evidence. We found very few artifacts. Whatever people were doing out there, it wasn't appropriate to leave a bunch of trash behind. So that we didn't find a lot of debris from making and using tools and those sorts of things. These post-hole excavations turned out to be much more interesting. So you see these little white flags here? We placed one of those in each of those magnetic anomalies, and then we opened this unit to expose two of those. And here's what they look like in plan view. You're saying, I don't see it. And they're really not very obvious, but if we cheat a little bit, there are two stains there, just slightly darker soil. And if we zoom in on one of them, that's the trace of one of these features. And you know, that's almost a meter across, 2.5 feet across. So it's a big thing. That's what they look like in plan view. And then we cut a little window down and cross-sectioned them, cut it down the middle, and so we could see what it looked like in profile. And I think you can see that the basic stratigraphy of the natural terrace that this sits on is there's a plow zone, there's a little bit of clay soil that we call the B horizon soil, and then below that is just sand and gravel, cobbles and sand mixed together. It's all glacial, used to be a riverbed in glacial days. So you can see here, if you trace the edge here, you can see that this has been excavated down into that sand and gravel, all the way from the surface, down through the A horizon, the B horizon, and down way deep into that sea. And so they're straight-sided, relatively flat-bottomed, 2.5 feet in diameter, 4 feet deep. So these are big, great big features. And one of the interesting things is, it's difficult to see, but the fill of these is stratified. There's very clearly a dark lens, a light lens, and then a dark lens. Question?
Did you comment? Say that was straight across, or from here it looks like there's like a little bow, like a bowl shape?
Well,
the bottom?
Yeah. This is the very bottom of the thing. It's not, I guess, it's flat-ish, but it is sort of bowed at the bottom. But pretty straight-sided, sort of distorted here from the view. But they're basically straight-sided. But the fact that the fill in them is stratified is interesting to me, because that suggests to me that if there was a wooden post in that hole, it didn't rot in place. You know, you would expect it to be homogeneous if that was the case. I think if there was a wooden post there, somebody pulled that thing out and then filled that hole back in intentionally. And we know they've done that at other places. We've seen that kind of thing in other Hopewell sites, so it's not unusual. Here's the second one that we looked at. It's basically a carbon copy of the first. Again, cut down into those sands and gravels. And again, it has a stratified fill. So, again, if these are posts, they were probably dismantled at some point. So that leads us to this question. If they're posts, how big are the posts? And I learned this graphic technique from a dear friend of mine, Nomi Grieber, who I'm a very famous archaeologist who just passed away. But she gave me my first field experience, and she taught me how to, don't fuss over the figures, son, just draw it. Okay, so, they're dancing. So how big were the posts? If the post holes, the post pits are 2.5 feet in diameter, if we allowed for, say, 6 inches on either side to get the post in the hole, then that would leave us with a post 18 inches in diameter. Pretty good size telephone pole, big telephone pole. And then there's a couple engineering formulas we can use to predict from the size of the post pit how tall the post might have been. So if you talk to a fence post installer, they would tell you that a third of the post ought to be buried in the ground. So ours are 4 feet deep. That would support a 12-foot fence post. Two-thirds of it, or 8 feet of it, would be exposed. But if you talk to a telephone pole installer, they use a different formula. They say, take the total length of your pole, you want to bury 10% of it, plus 2 feet for margin of error. So in that case, a 4 foot deep hole would support a 20 foot post with 16 feet exposed. So that's kind of the range I think these things might fall into. And the telephone pole guy would also tell you that a Class C telephone pole, which is 18 inches in diameter, made of cedar, they know how much those weigh. And they would say an 8 foot or a 12 foot length would be 320 pounds, 20 foot length would be 530 pounds. And that's a big post, but it's actually not huge. You know, it's not out of scale for what you can expect a group of committed people to transport over the landscape and stand up in a hole. Doesn't require any machines or outer space help or anything like that. This is within the realm of a group of committed humans. And this is hoping to give you some sense of the scale of the thing on the ground. You can kind of see the way that thing's arcing out there. Again, it's 400 feet in diameter. These guys, well, that little bluebird box there is sitting pretty much in the geometric center of the thing. Here's another attempt with 3D CAD to give you some sense. If the 16-foot pole version is the real one, that's what it might have looked like. A group of people standing around the posts, and then a group of people standing in the center. So this thing is really big. Not exactly Hopewellian regalia these guys are wearing there, but it gives you some sense of what the thing might have been like. And then we looked at the ditch, and it appeared to us as a dark stain in the soil on the surface. We didn't find a lot in it in terms of artifacts. There was a little bit of chert or flint debris, a few potsherds, and one hole artifact, which turned out to be a celt, classically they're called woodworking tools. This is the close-up view of that thing. You can see the business end of it is really battered to death. And so I think maybe it may have ended its life as a digging tool of some sort. And then maybe got tossed in the ditch. Cut down a post, dig a ditch, and throw the axe in. And this is what the profile of the ditch looked like after excavation. And So you can see that this is the basic stratigraphy. You've got the plow zone, this reddish B horizon, and then this sand and gravel C horizon. And here you can see where the Indians have excavated down all the way into that C horizon. And that's about, it ultimately, it was about a meter deep below the ground surface was the bottom of it. And then you can kind of see that there's some distinctive fills in that ditch. This will be another view of that. You can see there's clearly, there's like this reddish clay in the bottom, and then there's a dark lens on top. That kind of highlights it a little bit. So my interpretation is that this thing was excavated down into that sand and gravel, and then I think they put an intentional fill in there. This reddish clay is not, it's not just eroded into the ditch. It's distinct from the soil right around it. It doesn't have any, it's smooth clay. So it didn't come from, they had to quarry it somewhere. Probably not far away, but it had to be quarried and placed in there. And you can see it also, it has a shape to it. It pinches out on this end, but this end it follows up, and we're looking towards the interior of the circle is over here. And so what I actually think is happening is I think this may be the base of actually an embankment wall that carried up all the way up the profile, and then that might have been part of an earthen wall that was there. And this is the actual, this dark organic soil was the open base of the ditch when the Hopewell people were there. And you can imagine that ditch would very quickly get vegetation growing in it, and standing water and organic material accumulating, and so it would get to be dark like that. So that's what I think this soil accumulated in place over some centuries. All the artifacts we found were in that soil there, nothing down below it. And so there's where it might be, that embankment wall. So that's what the field data told us. Now we're going back and doing some lab data. This is Dr. Rolf Mandel from University of Kansas. He's a very famous soil geomorphologist. He was kind enough to come out and sample our profile for us. And now we're taking those samples back to the laboratory to get some really fine scale data on, you know, in the laboratory we can probably tell from the particle size and distribution, you know, whether these soils were silting in and washing in, or whether they're being intentionally placed, those kind of things we can get a firmer tack on. So we're working on that. All of the cataloging is finished at this stage. And as I mentioned before, we really didn't find much in the way of artifacts. And I think that in itself is instructive, that this place was kept clean. It was swept clear. So that's suggesting that it had a, you know, some sort of an important, probably ceremonial function. We also collected a whole bunch of soil samples, which we then processed by flotation, which is basically we dumped them in that 55-gallon drum with a hose running out it, and anything like charcoal and seeds and things would float to the top of the water, come out the spout, and we would catch it in this very fine mesh. And so now one of the students that was, we had a group of about six students, mostly from Ohio State University and other universities, was the crew who did all the hard work out there. One of them, Andrew Weiland here, he is studying to be a paleoethnobotanist, somebody who looks at those charred remains and can identify the seeds to species and the wood to species and such. He's working on that now. And interestingly, or it's unusual, the stuff he's finding is not what you find in habitation sites where you find a whole bunch of food remains. He's finding virtually nothing. It's food remains. Mostly what he's seeing is like environmental weeds, grasses and weeds that have been burned, though. So that's suggesting that this area was being burned off and kept clear of vegetation through burning, perhaps. He's working on it. All right, so the Great Circle Project. What do we know? What do we learn? And, you know, we've got a long way to go before we really understand what this thing was used for and what it means. And so all I can really do here is I'm going to point to some other things in other places that will give some hints as to what this thing might have been about. And those hints turn into hypotheses that we can go test in the field and try and figure out what this thing was used for. One interesting thing that Bill Romaine is an archaeoastronomer, and he, while we were still in the field, got a hold, we gave him some images, and he started working on this, and what he found is if you stand in the center of those four pits in the middle and peer out through the middle of that gateway on the summer solstice sunset, sunsets right down that gateway. So probably not by chance. But then there's this other gateway to the northeast. It doesn't point at anything. There's nothing in the sky, sun, or moon that sets or rises out there. But it happens to be exactly 90 degrees from that solstice alignment. Perfect orthogonal alignment. And then further, if you construct a square along that alignment, triangle, this length from here to here is what Bill calls the Hopewell measurement unit, 263 feet maybe. It's a quarter of 1,054 feet, which at Newark, Ohio, the circle and octagon there, that circle is 1,054 feet in diameter. And that length right there is exactly 1/4 of that. And that number, or multiples of 1,054, divisions of 1,054, show up in every Hopewell earthwork that he's looked at. So they had a common unit of measure that they were using, and certain measurements, for whatever reason, were important. And so I don't know what it means, but it must be important. It's probably a means of connecting this physical feature to something in the heavens, to some sacred measurement. It's a means of sacralizing this place, making it sacred.
Yeah. Has there been openings in the southwest?
Right.
The railroad road.
Yeah. There's a hint right there that there might have been a break in the ditch, but because it happens to fall right where that railroad is, we can't be sure that that's real without excavation there. So yeah, there could be a winter solstice sunset alignment there. But not sure at this stage. A couple other comparisons. So these circular embankments are what often were called sacred circles. There's lots of them. There's probably 500 of them in the Ohio Valley that are known. There were, on the plains here in Athens County, of course, a whole series of these little circles, sacred circles. And we have pretty good data on almost 200 of these that have survived and can be measured. And so we can get some basic statistics. 75% of them have a single gateway that opens out to the east. 94% of them have a ditch on the inside of the embankment. Most of them are small. More than half of them are under 150 feet in diameter. And there's only 5 that are bigger than 350 feet in diameter. And ours is about 375, 380 feet in diameter. So it's one of the biggest ones ever built, one of 5, the biggest. Ours has 2 gateways, not just one. And there's the ditches to the exterior, very rare feature. So the Hopewell site, again, stands out that when they built the circle at Hopewell, it was going to be the biggest, weirdest one of all of them. So that tells us something. It tells us it's different from all the others, or many of the others, and it's in a class of its own. This graphic, just for comparison, this is similar to that group here on the plains, similar in size. This is the junction group in just outside of Chillicothe, which was just recently saved from development by a grassroots. Local people came together and bought it off the auction block, so that one's safe. But the biggest one here is about 250 feet in diameter. Ours is, almost double that size. It's way outsized. A couple of other things. There's these things. There are post circles known from a lot of archaeological sites. People started to find these post circles back in the 30s and 40s. Archaeologists in the Works Progress Administration and these big make-work projects to excavate sites in Kentucky, basically what they did. And under many mounds, they found these paired post structure. You can see that there's very clearly two posts, so paired posts. Very distinctive pattern, and they found a bunch of these. So it's something, I don't know what it means, but it's very distinctive. Originally, folks thought, well, those are probably houses. You know, maybe that's the chief's house. The chief died, buried him in the house, built a mound over it. Good idea, but it didn't hold up to actual data. And people have shown, archaeologists have shown, that there's really no domestic debris around these things. There's no trash in them. So they're not houses. Whatever they are, they're not houses. And then more recently, just in the last year, a paper came out where they looked at these things, and many of them occur in places where there's no mounds at all. They're not connected with mortuary funeral activity. They're just these shell, you know, probably open air. They probably didn't even have roofs. These fences, but built in this very distinctive way, out over the landscape. And apparently, they were very careful to clean these things up because there's no artifacts associated. So it's hard to know what they are from that standpoint. In the 1960s, at a place called Cahokia, it's a great big, the biggest mound north of Mexico, near St. Louis, there's a city of, you know, maybe 20, 30, 40,000 people lived there 1,000 years after Hopewell. But they were widening a highway there, and this guy, Warren Whitry, found this great big pit. He dug into the pit, and it happened to have a great big cedar post in the bottom of it. And the water table was high enough that it preserved the post. And then they opened the area up, and they found out that it sits in a circle. And so this was the first American wood henge. You know, that's where that term, you know, like Stonehenge, only in wood. This, at Cahokia in the 60s, was the first American wood henge. And subsequent excavations, they found there's actually probably at least five of these post circles that overlap one another at the same place. So the thing was apparently built, rebuilt. They think that it was used as a calendar of some sort. And there are very clear alignments marking important dates in the solar calendar. And there's a reconstruction of what that thing might have looked like out in front of Monk's Mound. Closer to home, there's another example at a place called the Stubbs Earthwork, which is down near Cincinnati. Turned out to be a really good, you know, there was this geometric earthwork was mapped back in the 1800s, and it had a small circular embankment. Turned out this was a good place to build a new high school in the 1990s, you know, very recently. And but they allowed some archaeology to happen beforehand, and Frank Cowan investigated that small circular enclosure, and he found the first Hopewell wood henge. And in this case, it was a ring of posts, 172 of them, a smallish sort of big post, a small telephone pole sized post, 172 of them in a very, you know, very closely spaced all the way around, different from ours, and ours is much more widely spaced. Again, no artifacts to know what people were doing there. Fort Ancient site, very near where that last one is, over near Dayton, Hilltop Hopewell enclosure. Another of Jared Burks' surveys found this complex magnetic feature that, if you delve into that data, you can see that there's probably three concentric rows of wooden posts. And in the center there, there's a hugely magnetic feature that you can see here. Heavily oxidized, probably burned soil, surrounded by intentional deposits of broken vessels, fancy vessels, placed around it. Again, I mean, it screams of ritual behavior, but the details of it are lost to us. I'm going to skip a couple here. And now I just want to point out, this is a very famous site called Poverty Point. It's down in Louisiana. It's on the Mississippi River floodplain. This place is about 4,000 years old. It's the one of the earliest earthworks ever built, and it's one of the biggest. It's got these big embankments, concentric rings of embankments. It's something like 3/4 of a mile from one end to the other. This is the first one built. It's the biggest. This mound, Mound A, is the second biggest mound in North America. And this thing's 4,000 years ago. It's built by not agriculturalists. These are hunter, fisher, gatherers built this thing. And one of the cool things that's just been discovered is out in this area that's been called a plaza, something like 30 or 40 ring-shaped features have been found in magnetic survey. And they've done a little bit of testing on a few of them. It does look like these are post-circles. So that's 4,000 years ago. American Indians are already building these post-circle things. So it's an ancient, enduring tradition. And it endures up into the present time. This is a really rare photograph of the Sundance ceremony. This photograph was taken in 1886, Alberta, Canada, among the Blackfoot. And this young man is undergoing the Sundance, which is basically a blood sacrifice. He's offering up his suffering for the benefit of his people, his family, maybe he's asking for someone to be healed, maybe he's asking for personal power, but a very widespread practice all over the plains and endures to the present day. This is on the Blackfoot Reservation in Canada. This is their current Sundance grounds. And you can see it's basically a wooden post circle. In the middle, there's a great big post that is envisioned as the Tree of Life, or the center, the axis of the universe. And if you were to go to the Pine Ridge Lakota Reservation today, you'd see this Sundance circle, again, in the center, a living tree to represent that Tree of Life. So this thing is, you know, I don't know that these are all historically connected, but they fit together as ancient and enduring tradition. The last thing I'll say is one way to think about these things is many Native American ceremonial grounds are little models of the cosmos, is really what they're doing. They're making models of their cosmos. And all through the plains, eastern woodlands, at contact, there was a sort of pretty common conception of the way the universe was organized. It had three levels. Our world, there's an upper world that's occupied by thunderbirds and lightning and those upper world forces. Then there's a dark and watery underworld that's occupied by underwater panthers and powerful, not necessarily evil, but definitely dangerous things. And our world is conceived of as a circle or an island with four quadrants to it, north, south, east, west. And this cross and circle motif shows up on all kinds of pottery and pipes, and it's a little model of the universe is what that cross and circle is. And places like caves and posts and holes that you dig in the ground are potentially portals into that lower world, places where things can come and go from those other realms. And so, you know, maybe that post-circle at Hopewell Mound Group is a model of the cosmos. And maybe those post-holes are, you know, it was important to dig that hole, put a post in it that would connect the lower world and the upper world with this wooden post, maybe. I mean, these are hints and hypotheses that we can look at. And this sort of thing is going on today. If you went to the stomp dance grounds of the Muscogee tribe in Oklahoma today, you'd see this ceremonial ground where it's hard to make out, but they're clearly dancing around a circle with a sacred fire in the middle. And so the next, if we were to return to the Great Circle, I think the next place we need might need to look is right there in the center to understand what those four features are. That may well be a clue to the function of this thing. Hopefully they left some clue behind there that might tell us why it was this was so important for them to build. And lastly, I gotta put in a plug for I had an awesome team of about, as it all turned up, about seven students who are all going on as undergrads and graduate students to become professional archaeologists, and they did a lot of hard work out there that I get to take all the glory for, so I very much appreciate my archaeological resources team. So that's the Great Circle Project, and thank you.